Thanks, Monique. So hey everyone, my name is Jay. I am a product coach at Industrial Logic. Monique and myself and Julius behind the scenes run this space every Friday from 3 to 4 p.m. Eastern time, and we just feature different topics, different experts in the field, sharing their perspective and answering any questions that anyone might have about the featured topic. So today we're talking about how to make user stories work for you, and the discussion is going to be led by Tim Batty. He's on the stage. So Tim, if you want to take a minute and kind of just introduce yourself to everyone and talk a little bit about how you've gotten where you are now, and then we can kind of start that discussion.
Sure. Thanks, Jay. My name is Timothy Batty, and I have been working for a while as a consultant with Industrial Logic, worked with some different teams in different, mostly Java space, but also React Native and some other things. But worked with a number of different teams and have observed some interesting things, regarding the way that user stories are used, but more importantly, the importance of understanding the value behind them or what the purpose of them are or what problems they're solving. But that's
awesome. And then just like Muneeb said a little while ago, if anyone's in the audience and wants to either ask Tim a question or add a comment or a thought to what we're saying, please request to speak, and then myself and one of the other co-hosts will raise you up to the stage so you can ask that question yourself. If you are joining from your desktop and you can't request to speak, feel free to DM myself or Muneeb or the Industrial Logic page a question, and we'll make sure that it gets answered. We want to make sure that everyone
can meanwhile, I would request Julius if you can also put up the blog that we are referring to today. Authored by Tim, if you can put it on top, that'll be great, so that people can also look at that during the space. All right, so let's start from the basic question. Tim, what made you want to write this blog?
Well, so it's kind of an interesting story that I at one point, working with several different teams, it's kind of interesting. Each new team is a little bit, there's a lot that's the same, but then there's little things that are like different. And at one point I was working with one of the managers at a higher level in one of the companies I was at was deciding that they were going to start tracking metrics of cycle time and throughput and things like that, which are great metrics to track. Except that it requires that you understand when your stories are starting and stopping in order to know that information. So a lot of the teams didn't have any understanding of those kind of concepts. And I was starting to work with some of the teams, and some of the teams that I came across was kind of blew me away of how far they were from understanding the value of what a user story even was, as opposed to, not just being able to track when a story started or when a story ended, becomes meaningless if your user stories are like, well, we have three user stories per iteration. One is all the development work, one is all the testing, and one is all the deployment. It's like, and people who have complete lack of understanding of what, and this is being forced on them. That you have to, from someone higher saying you have to do this thing called user stories. And they're like, okay, well, we'll just, wrap user stories around whatever we're doing, call them user stories. And now we're doing what our boss wants us to. And realizing that there's actually a lot of power and value in the way of working that user stories is a part of. And if you try to pull something like this out of that methodology, that way of working, you completely lose the value that it would give you. And some of the experiences that I've had that helped me to recognize, wow, there's some in some areas, there's some need for people to understand what is the value that a user story brings to a system of work.
Excellent.
So starting from there, what type of information or structure does a user story need, like at its foundation, from your perspective?
What type of so the structure, so the context of it's about the context of where it fits into the way that you work that is so important to understand. And at the essence of it is the idea that we're looking to work in small slices, if you will, in small pieces of work that you can very quickly and easily validate certain assumptions, especially the riskier ones, earlier, and to be able to discard certain ideas that think that they look like they'll work based on certain assumptions that you're making, but when you actually the rubber hits the road, you realize they don't work, which has this to do with going all the way to production quickly, as early as possible, before you have a functioning app even, but to have something that can at least be deployed, like a walking skeleton type of idea. And when you have a user story, the story is that smaller slice that represents that vertical slice of something that can go all the way to production as an individual thing that can show you something, either a validating assumption or adding some small bit of work, or some small bit of value or a feature or something to that effect that can then help you to move forward, at least not breaking anything. The smallest type of stories can just be something, depending on what you, the type of nature of the application, that could be something that doesn't actually accomplish much, but it does in fact not break anything in the way.
So Tim, yeah. it might help if you mentioned the idea earlier that that people would have user stories for, you know, maybe a user a screen, and then a user story for an API, and then a user story for deploying it, and then you sort of gave a chuckle. But I wonder, I've seen this thing you're talking about on many, many teams. So I wonder if anybody listening out there might have, you know, wonder what, you know, what the chuckle was about. What is, how do you contrast that use of user stories with what you just described?
Sure. I think that the context, that the thing that we're trying to move away from here, the reason that user stories ever came about was, you know, the invention of user stories, if you will, was to solve a problem. And there's a specific problem that still needs to be solved. It's a solution to a specific problem. And the specific problem was things taking so long, delays, missed requirements, and all this. And it was, you know, described by the word waterfall. And it basically means that you do all the design first, then you do all the development, then you do all the testing, then you do all the deployment, one big bang. And the whole idea behind the XP movement and most of the Agile methodologies was the idea that we want to work in smaller pieces so that we don't have all of the problems that come along whenever you have this large period of time of designing, and then this large period of time of development, and this large period of time of testing, and then a deployment at the end of that. And I think that when we call something a user story, but we're following that exact same pattern, then we've done was just renamed waterfall to be the same thing functionally. It's not solving any of the problems. But we're just using new words to describe what we're doing. And I think that the core of the issue is, you know, we want to be able to solve the problems that whatever you call that way of working, whether you call it waterfall or whether you call it agile, it doesn't matter what the name of it is. What matters is what the essence of it is. You can call something a user story, but if it's following the pattern of, you know, a whole bunch of design up front, then a whole bunch of time, you know, breaking in that same pattern of what was called waterfall, then you're not actually solving the problems that could be solved by user stories.
So user story rather than being like just a single task in what could be, as you say, a waterfall, you're saying a user story is a tight bundle, like the smallest possible number of tasks that you can take to production at a time.
Yes. Yes. A user story has to do with the problem that the user stories is solving, and the framework, if you will, that it fits into is something that comes from the idea that small vertical slices, small individual units of work that can go all the way to production is the best way to work because of the feedback cycles of if things break, you have fewer things that are going wrong. So you have fewer things that you've changed. So you've got fewer things you need to check. And so it's much quicker and easier to move, to identify those and to fix them and to move forward, as well as any other things that you would not expect that would suddenly bubble up that become issues. You begin to identify those things much quicker than you do when you take large chunks of work and send those to production.
So it has to hold some sort of intrinsic value, end-to-end intrinsic value that you can, you know, get into the hands of the customer.
Yeah, and I think that's interesting because the idea of intrinsic value is somewhat relative. What one person's idea of intrinsic value is a fully polished app that does everything I want to do. And I think that being able to shift that definition of intrinsic value from something that has everything I asked for to something that can contribute something. And sometimes it's a lot harder to describe than it is to demonstrate. But, you know, for instance, if you have an app that you want to be able to add a functionality that lets you save to a database, a user profile. You know, you could have something that has a slice that shows a screen that, you know, this is where feature toggles become very valuable, that you have a button that, you know, can take you to that first, but that's not necessarily going to do anything. It just show up, hey, this feature is coming soon. You know, let us know if this is something that you're excited about or interested in or something. As a first slice before you do any of the other work that would need to be done. And that might not be a great example, but it's an idea of shifting our definition of what is a valuable thing, you know, what is something that's going to be able to get delivered all the way to production and help us either validate an assumption or, you know, bring some new functionality that's adding value for the user.
So let's say I'm a product owner or some other kind of business person who I know what I want the app to do. I know what I want in the app. I just need the development team to make it. Why would I want you guys to screw around with all that? What sounds like a lot of overhead to deploy to production, like these small bundles of tasks, when I know what it should do and I've written it down for you. Like why would I want you guys to do that?
That is that's a good question. And I think the idea behind it is the perspective of someone who asks a question like that, all they see is what the app does. They don't understand all of the things that have to be involved in that to make things work correctly. And I think that sometimes when you can, and this is also something that you're right, when you start doing this, you need to begin to solve problems of the amount of time it takes for a deployment to take place. And this is where CI/CD comes into play, and it becomes, it starts making this, the idea that all the trouble, you mentioned all the trouble going to the production. I think that it makes a lot of sense to examine assumptions that say, is it a lot of trouble to go to production? Because if, and a lot of many companies have been able to tackle that and say, why does it take a lot of trouble to go to production, and then begin to solve the problem so that it can go to production with a simple click of a button, and it's very fast and very easy and non-event. And whenever that becomes the case, then the question of I want to be able, you know, I know everything it wants to do, and I understand why we want to, you know, I know what everything's supposed to look like. I know exactly what the user is going to want, and I know exactly how all users are going to respond to this, and I am 100% confident that if people will just do what I say, everything will work perfectly. I think that whenever we have that fully formed thing in our head, the problem is that we don't know what we don't know. So what if you can get rid of the problem of this is really hard to go to production, this is really hard to do a deployment, then the question just becomes, what's the value I get out of implementing things in small pieces as opposed to the whole thing that I want to be accomplished all in one batch, so I can be announce a release and have it be a big event. And I think that has to do with the ship it be a big event. And I think that has to do with the shifting of mindset of realizing that there is a cost to announcing a release date and not meeting that release date for the company, a financial cost, because you start losing credibility. And oftentimes when you work in large batches, you miss release dates. And I think that there's a number of solutions. There's a number of problems that come of large batches. You very often miss requirements, or there's things that people assumed that they were wrong assumptions because they weren't getting enough feedback, because the person who was saying, this is what I want to look like, there's distance between them and the people actually doing the work. And from them to be able to catch and say, no, that's not what I meant. You know, whenever you have communication that's passed along through any documentation or any kind of communication, there's always things that are missed. And it's impossible to communicate perfectly in such a way that nothing has to be explained more than once, right? That's just that's a dream. And it's also a dream, to the idea that we can always prevent every possible problem before it happens. It's this idea that we can know the future. And that's something that is just one of the assumptions that Agile is just basically accepted, saying, you know, or you know, when you work in small batches, what you're saying is that, you know what, I've given up on the belief that I'm going to be able to accurately predict every possible thing and give the solution to it right away that could go wrong. And
yeah,
so
no,
I then have the ability to give the perfect solution at the very beginning. And so I think that there's, I hope that answered your question. I didn't go too far into the weeds or off topic.
Yeah, but, you know, the thing that you're missing is this time's different, Tim.
The idea is that there's
we've missed it in the past.
Sometimes when there's time between, there's a lot of different reasons, you know. Time is wasted because of queues, and, you know, whenever you have increased patch sizes, you have increased queues. And that means there's periods of time whenever nothing's being done on the thing that actually needs to be deployed, or the thing is actually, you know, the feature or the functionality, and inflexibility if something suddenly changes. Oftentimes we have this idea that so much effort was put into the design phase of this that we, you know, when something comes up that's a new thing is learned that suddenly changes something in a certain way, the idea is, oh, we can't make any changes because that is this is the way that we had to do it, because we put so much effort into doing it, into designing this and making these decisions, that we have to stick with them now, because there's this mental block that tends to happen in our minds, where when we put certain amount of effort into something, we feel like we own it, and if it needs to be changed, we feel very there's a pain to us that we experience internally to wanting to have to change that. And in the blog I mentioned causing delays, missing requirements. Oftentimes you hit poor code quality, miss assumptions, There's a lot of things that can go wrong when we use big when we use large batches.
It looks like we have a question from Anthony.
Yeah, I just had another comment based on John's scenario. I think it touches on another aspect, I think, that's commonly misunderstood with user stories, is that they're not supposed to be.
Was there another question?
So
can you hear Anthony?
Tim, can you hear us?
Am I?
I think he's not able to hear us. Still... Can hear anybody?
Connected? Anything working?
Let me just send him a message. And meanwhile, Anthony, go ahead with what you were saying.
Yeah, I think what John was, the kind of scenario John was painting is a common thing I think we see a lot with user stories, is that we treat them as just a way to write prescriptive requirements and hand them off to development teams, and just treating the development teams as order takers. And I think that was another key.
So I guess the basic premise is the idea that the value of small batches is not just because you don't know what you're developing or what you want the product to look like. That wouldn't be why you do small batches. The reason you do small batches is because you just don't know the future. And and that kind of helps with being able to okay, I'm gonna leave.
I think he got my message. Tim, if you can rejoin, I think you are not able to hear anybody. All right, Anthony, sorry for that. You can continue now.
No worries. Yeah, I was just saying that I think another one of the reasons Kent Beck came up with user stories was to get away from prescriptive requirements and treating development teams as order takers. And it was really to have that conversation between the people with the problem, right? So whether it's your business or your customers or users of the system, and the people that can solve the problem, the development team or developers. So I think what kind of gets lost is, I think what I see really commonly happen is that you still get these some intermediary in the company that, as John pointed out, knows exactly what they need the software engineers to do, and they will write something down in a format that looks like a user story and then call it a user story, but it's really just prescriptive requirements, you know, being waterfalled onto development teams.
Hey, Tim, welcome back. Are you able to hear everybody now?
Yes, I can hear again. I don't know what happened there.
Awesome. Yeah, sometimes that happens. That's okay.
Perfect. So, okay, so Anthony was just talking about how at times people will write some intermediary in the company, and Anthony, correct me if I'm just completely misstating this, will write what they think is a user story, but really it's just a list of requirements, right? Like predetermined requirements. When we talk about user stories, and hold on, before I ask that question, I just wanted to let everyone in the room know, if you did want to raise your hand to speak, to share a comment or a question, please do. And myself and one of the other co-hosts will bring you up so you can do that. I wanted to ask, when you talk about just getting a list of requirements versus including the development team and creating those stories, right? Like as problem solvers for what you're trying to accomplish, how does decision-making factor into that, right? Because I know at a lot of organizations, decision-making is top-down only. How does that decision-making structure need to change and able to enable a development team to kind of function in the way that you're talking about?
Yeah, that's a good question, in that there is a significant difference that needs to take place in the thinking And the way that we kind of go about the process of deciding to write software or deciding what we're going to do with software. And I think that when we are, when we are, the old way of working, or the way that was working with in Waterfall, and it is very common even today, is the idea that I'm going to hand down a set of requirements, and we're going to call it a user story, and then the next layer of people, they do the things they're supposed to do, and if you have a problem, you know, let me, you know, ask me a question. The difference is that whenever a user story is used as a placeholder for a conversation, then what's happening is that there is at the top level, there is, hey, I want to communicate the goals or the intentions. I'm not communicating the literal exact things to do. And when we can make a subtle shift like that and begin to draw on the ideas and the creativity and the knowledge and understanding of the people underneath us who have their, you know, on the feet on the ground, so to speak, that we can begin to have better solutions in the end. There's a great book called Turn the Ship Around, where it describes a captain of a submarine describes how he shifted from a leader follower model to a leader leader model. And you hear a lot of the idea of people saying, "Oh, we want to empower the people in our company today." And oftentimes the problem is not that the people are needing to be told that they should be empowered. It's the problem that there are certain things that they don't have control over, and that whenever we begin to allow for a passing of control to lower levels of, and so that everything isn't requiring a checkoff, so to speak, then we can begin to have, it tends to open up the minds of the people at a lower, who are on the ground floor, so to speak, to begin to communicate back, and you start having better feedback cycles where, oh, this is a great idea, and I think I want to do this. Oh, well, the cost of this is actually a lot higher than the cost of doing something similar, but is not exactly what you're saying to do. And so when we begin to have conversations instead of passing down a dictation of this is what you got to do, then it tends to be a little bit messier, in that you don't just pass it down and walk away. And there has to be sometimes there's points where people disagree on, and there's things where there has to be boundaries sometimes set for, this is the things that are negotiable, these are things that are not. But that has to do with understanding the values and understanding the intentions. And I think that if you have a company that is able to make a shift in their in the way that they work, especially those at the top, to begin to say, you know what, I want not a bunch of yes men in me, but I want people who are going to actually think, and they're going to sometimes disagree with me, but I'm going to know that they are invested in what we're doing, and that if they're thinking about why we would do the things that we do as well. And I think that in the end, you have a much healthier organization. And I think that there's a lot of reasons why that doesn't happen. I think that the root of it is sometimes fear, but, but I think there's a lot of value in being able to shift from, an idea of this has to be passed down, and the person who is, at the top passing things down is the person who knows everything. And they're then responsible to know everything. And if they make a mistake, then everything falls apart, as opposed to having a lot of people who understand deeply about what there's going on, and they're and there's like a more of a conversation happening. I hope that answers the question. It's a challenging one for sure, for when we're dealing with the real implementation of trying to improve the way that an organization works.
So Tim, a lot of time what I've experienced in enterprises in which software development teams is that you will go into these organizations and there will be component teams. And when you look at their Jira boards or their user stories, they look more like technical tasks rather than more of a user story. So in that scenario, when you go into like these component teams, do you think user stories could be valuable because they are kind of working in silos?
Yeah, I think that the problem of having silos is it's a deep problem that's not solved by one thing. There's several things that have to be done to begin to kind of break down knowledge silos, and that causes a lot of problems in a lot of companies. Because, I was just recently reminded that again, in that there was a company that a certain thing was done and that person left the company and they were the only person who knew about this thing. And the company was in a hot place, in a difficult spot for a while because of the silos. And I think that recognizing silos as a problem and asking questions of how do we, you know, what are some ways that we as a company can eliminate the problems that come from knowledge silos or the knowledge silos themselves. And I think that when you see a lot of technical stories, if you will, or, you know, on the Jira board, these things that are being called stories are, you know, you work on this, this, and this, and you work on this, and this, and this, there's some orchestrator that's having to decide, and they have an understanding of how they think things should be done. And I think that when you can begin to have the people at a lower level be more involved in the design phase of that, there needs to be, then things can begin. And I think that also there's a lot of things that would, depending on how deeply rooted and how long it's been going on in an organization, sometimes you have to have some pretty significant shifts in the way that people think about work and the way that work is done in order to make those changes work, in the sense that you have this mindset that, oh, I've got an expert that they're the one that's creating all the stories for everyone to work on, and they're handing them to these people because everyone's working in individuals, you know, everyone's working individually as opposed to pairing or mobbing. And so this person is the only person that knows about this part of the program or the application. This person is the only person that knows this thing. And so I have to give stories like this to this person and stories like that to that person. And it creates a lot of unnecessary stress and a lot of work and time consumed trying to juggle all of those types of things. They call it, there's a term for it, but I can't remember off the top of my head. It's like spread it out and gather it back or something like that. But it's the idea that we have this thing that needs to be accomplished. In order for it accomplished, a lot of different things have to be accomplished in order for that to happen. And what you really want to be able to have is people who are more generalists and can understand, okay, we have a few people that maybe this person has a clear understanding of this, and this person has a clear understanding of that part of the system, then talking together and working together so that they're together, they're able to implement it much quicker than if there's things being passed back and forth. And I think that's what's really happening whenever you see a scenario where there's a whole bunch of extremely technical things that are called user stories that people are working on, is that there's a much bigger issue to be addressed in the way that we are looking at efficiency in work.
Yeah, I think you got real close to making a reference to Scatter Gather, which was a post from our from Otter, or as we might call him in this context, Other Tim. And it ties in with sort of another. There was a Radio Lab, I want to say, years ago, podcast where they talked in general, not just in the software realm, but why projects tend to fail. And one of the key ideas was something they called coordination neglect, which was it's very easy to subdivide the labor, to break up the individual tasks, but we often underestimate and neglect the effort that it's going to take to put all that stuff back together at the end.
Yeah, exactly.
So Tim Oettinger is also in our audience. Perhaps he's too busy to join the speaker, but he's been commenting under the space, and he said, a document tends to be a stand-in for an absent expert. If you have the expert at hand participating in the development, you need less written down. And he said, a standard complaint I hear is that they can't get all the specifications in the user story. They aren't sure how to fit in the complete issue. So there's some interesting comments underneath the space. Meanwhile, Jimmy has joined us in the speaker. Welcome, Jimmy. Thank you for joining, and go ahead, whatever you want to say.
So two different things. Can you all hear me okay?
Yep.
Perfect.
Two different things that in my experience I've come across, and one is going to be how the team is held to agreements from the person who's creating the JIRA cases. And the other side of this is the person who's creating the JIRA cases, whether it be a project manager or product owner, that they themselves were a developer in the past. And so there's this space that when you're doing a user story in a way to encourage thought, imagination, you're not locking something down in a user case to have an agreement with the team to do, because then that just turns into a job ticket. When you have somebody that went through that before as a developer on a team, and then now is that person who is over the project as a project owner, product owner or project manager, they are just doing what they saw that was successful in the past, and it still just kind of makes it hard to kind of unlearn and realize agreements, although how powerful they are, there needs to be some wiggle room for growth when you're doing the development. And sometimes that's the part that hits the team the most, where, oh, we need to pivot on something because we just found a dragon, or there's an unknown that's not known. And sometimes because of how the JIRA case is created, it's much harder for the team to be able to pivot outside of that.
Yeah, one of the things that I've been experimenting with lately is the idea of discovery trees, which are very interesting.
Yeah, we did have a space on that a few weeks back. So that was definitely an interesting space that we had. And I can actually post the recording up top, so people who are interested in discovery trees can learn more about it.
Yeah, and those tend to help solve the problems of there's something that, we just found a dragon and now we've got to completely change what we thought we were going to be spending our time on. And because it's a way of kind of recording that in such a way that tells a story that sometimes is lost whenever you have a set of requirements broken up in nice, neat packages. And then there's the questions of why is this not being done in the time that it should be done, because it was broken up so neatly, and then there has to be a whole, revisiting of everything, and that whole process becomes a time waster. But But yeah, I think that's one of the things that's really important about user stories being a placeholder for conversations. You know, that not documentation, not a list of requirements, but, you know, basically, here are the problems that we're wanting to solve. Here's the current flow of the system. Here are the proposed changes that we want to make to that flow. And you know, do we have any questions or suggestions, or what do we think is the best way to do this? It looks like it might be this, but there is, you know, does anyone see any problem with that? And I think that with those types of conversations, user story can be a very powerful tool as a, you know, a part of a team that you know, does feel empowered and does already have these other things in place to begin to really accomplish things in an effective way.
I think Chris in the audience also commented, and he shared one of the Kent Beck's quotes regarding this topic. And Kent Beck says, software development has been steered wrong by the word requirement, which is defined in the dictionary as something mandatory or obligatory. The word carries a connotation of absolutism and permanence. It's inhibitors to embracing change, and the word requirement is just plain wrong. I think he's absolutely right. So one other thing that came to my mind, and when I got introduced to user stories several years back, one of the principles called the invest principle was something that everybody was kind of focusing on as far as user stories were concerned. Timothy, in your experience, is the invest principle is something you have used or, you know, coached people about, and has it been valuable?
Yeah, I find that there's a number of different mechanisms like invest that are valuable. You know, the three C's, Rivet, Connextra method. There's a number of ways that when you're writing a user story that can help you to try to get the most value out of it. And I think that the important thing behind a lot of these methodologies is that there is an understanding of what you're trying to accomplish and what problems you're trying to avoid. You know, you're trying to defer detail analysis. You're trying to, you know, identify things that are going to be the most difficult elements or the biggest risks and try to tackle those first, you know, the ideas. And I think that as we, you know, we can waste a certain amount of time trying to have a exact pattern of how these things are supposed to be written, like what words you're supposed to use. And sometimes it's necessary if there's a lack of understanding of what we're trying to accomplish or what our goal is in doing user stories. I find that a lot of times, if there's a strong understanding of, you know, why are we using user stories and what are we accomplishing? What is our goal? And how are we able to utilize this in such a way that it's going to maximize our ability to be flexible and to be able to keep our focus on what the most important things are that need to be done. I think that there's a number of different ways that can be accomplished. I find that, the idea of using invest or three C's and some of the different things that I've incorporated a lot of those ideas whenever I'm writing user stories or whenever I'm involved in trying to define what a certain unit or slice of work would look like. And sometimes it's, you know, not until you get started that you realize, you know, if we just, you know, did this one thing, we cut out half of this and, oh, okay, great, let's do that, because that will help us to get to a place where we have a simpler use case, but it's able to get to production faster, and we can verify anything that we don't know. Because the big problem is the things that I don't know. You know, the same reason the reasons that we work in small slices.
So, Tim, to that point, I wanted to take a second to just say hey to everyone that's joined the room in the last few minutes. If you did want to raise your hand or request to speak to ask a question or share a comment or a thought, please do. And myself and one of the other co-hosts will bring you up to the stage so you can do that. I wanted to ask, Tim, as you talk about the process of writing a user story and you talk about exploring it not in a silo and with a team, what, as far as timelines are concerned, how much time should a team spend developing a user story? And then once it's developed, how much time should they spend refining it and revisiting it?
It's a good question. It's interesting, you know, that can be a difficult question to answer based on, because there's a lot of contexts in which you find yourself having to try to identify or develop a certain time of work, but a certain element that you want to have deployed to production. I think that oftentimes what you want to try to have a fairly small amount of time in actually defining a story or originally, you know, it's basically you want something very short there to just basically capture an idea of what you want accomplished, so that when you actually go to develop it is whenever the most of the time is being spent on discussion about how this is going to be developed. So when you actually start doing it, you realize, oh, okay, we have to, you know, we have to change directions because the first thing we thought we were going to do isn't actually possible. Or because we implemented this other thing that had to be implemented, now this is the way this is going to be implemented is very different. And so we want to really avoid spending very much time going into very detailed analysis whenever we're developing a story. We want to spend much more time whenever we're actually working on the story, talking with the people who understand exactly how this is supposed to look, so that there can be a discussion of saying, you know, if you do it this way, the way that you think it would be really cool, it would take, you know, three times as long as if you did it this other way that's actually very similar and accomplishes the same thing. And so you can have those kind of conversations open up whenever you don't have a whole bunch of time spent on the design up front, which is, you know, the writing a lot of details about a user story. Now, there's certain things that sometimes you have to capture because someone explains all these things to you. And that's where, you know, we want to try to shift to working in such a way that this long list of requirements is being passed down the layers of managers, that type of thing. We want to try to eliminate that scenario by having smaller vertical slices and less complicated, you know, simpler systems.
So meanwhile, we got a comment from Tim Oettinger. He said, it seems to me that organizations new to Agile tend to focus with laser intensity on the artifacts and miss the principles and practices. Also, since it's supposed to be an improvement, they focus on making the artifacts better to be compatible with their past needs and processes. So, Tim, by the end of your blog post, you talked about splitting stories. And I know there's been a lot of focus on slicing, vertical slicing, horizontal slicing. So if you can shed some light on that, that'll be great.
Sure. Yeah. I think that, you know, a lot of talk on this is basically the idea of the value of slicing things into smaller pieces, slicing units of work into smaller items that can go individually to production, so that we can, you know, move the needle, a lot faster in the end towards where we're going. And I think that the ability to slice a story into or split a story into, when we realize that the story is larger than it needs to be able to deploy something to production is going to add value. That's a powerful skill to nurture. And I think that it involves this idea of constantly questioning, could we do less? What's the least we can get away with and have this and the app not be broken, so to speak? And you know, oftentimes it takes it requires a thinking outside of the box and a looking at saying, okay, so we have these, you know, set of things that we want to eventually have implemented. What do we need to have done in order to have those implemented? And is there something that we could do that's a lesser version with less configuration possible or less, you know, less functionality that just does the one thing, you know, as opposed to, and this is a lot, and understanding the splitting of stories and understanding the mindset behind what the value is that you're delivering, and being able to say, okay, this is the essence of what we're wanting to accomplish. Sometimes in the process of splitting stories, you realize that, wait a second, we can actually only just do this one thing. We don't have to do these other things because they're not even being used by, you know, they may or may not be used by customers, or they're something that's actually taking a lot more effort. You know, for instance, you can have something that's deployed, but not designed perfect, or the UX isn't perfectly designed, and then go back through later and have the UX stuff added to make it look really pretty. And in some contexts, that works just fine. In other contexts, there's, you know, you can have a certain thing that you can only have one choice. You know, you select one thing and it just does that one thing. But I think that oftentimes, you know, there's the idea that we want, you know, when we come up with a thing, there's often, when we come up with a feature of a type of functionality that we want to have implemented, it's often this conversation that takes place when there's a lot of design up front. There's a conversation like, oh, what about this? What if people want this? Or what if people want that? Or what if people want to do this? Or what about this or that? And so then all these other things get added to it. And now you have something that's much larger than you, what you actually needed. And I think that it is the ability of splitting stories is the idea of deconstructing and being able to kind of roll back in time and saying, what was the initial problem that was being solved? And what's the simplest way to solve that problem? And then we can add more of the bells and whistles as separate things that can be done as separate commits and separate stories. So to sum it up, I think it requires a deeper understanding of what it is that you're actually implementing, and what the value is that you're getting from that implementation. And then is there any way that, you know, what are the requirements that need to happen in order for that to function? And is there any way that any point you can find a seam that you can split on?
All right, go ahead, Jimmy.
So, Tim, with your vast knowledge, knowing what you know right now and knowing that words are powerful, what would you call user stories now to help out if we could make that change through the whole entire community?
I'm trying to understand your question. You're asking what if we were to rename a user story to something else?
Right, because it could come across as to somebody as something else. So if we were to change the actual what a user story is, like just the name, and not have a user story, what would be something else that you would put in place that could possibly help all of the issues and problems and pain points that we've seen so far right now? Would you be able to rename it? That would be my question. And saying no is completely valid. I was just curious if you ever thought about that.
I wish that renaming something would solve all the depth of problems that are involved in this. that would be so wonderful. If I were to pick a name, I would say Vertical Slice. But I think that any name that's given, unfortunately, is going to be defined in the context of wherever a person is. And I think that what really needs to be more deeply communicated is a deeper understanding of what are the things that you're lining up here that make for giving the actual value that you're going to get out of this. And until there's a deeper understanding of why small batch sizes are so powerful in the context of software development, and why deferring detailed analysis is so powerful, until you can begin to understand that the meaning behind it, or the depth of here's the reasons why this works in the way that it does, it's very difficult to have a name be able to capture all of that.
I think they called it user story because, you know, it was the perspective of the end user or a customer and how a piece of work will deliver a value back to the customer. So that's why they wanted to call it a user story. And even if you read any story, it is always from the point of view of a person, of a user. So that's what they were trying to emphasize.
You know, Muneeb, it's funny how, well, it's okay, it's heartbreaking how much that, how little that matters actually now that the term user story has gotten polluted. You know what I mean? And there's an interesting assumption in Jimmy's question that by choosing a new name, we can sidestep that pollution and somehow get the idea through that what we've been calling user stories is not. And what, you know, basically sort of a meta discussion on the whole discussion is like, we're trying to get around assumptions by validating them in small slices, right? So can we validate Jimmy's assumption by trying something somewhere?
Yeah.
Let's hear from Tim Oettinger. He is on the speaker with us. Welcome, Tim.
Hey. Well, I was just going to offer that there's this euphemism treadmill, and really user story is such a completely different name than specification ever was, that I think if the fact that they took the name and applied it to what they did before suggests that they would do the same thing. So if we were to call them, you know, investigation stories or intention to explore, I think they would just write a spec and use the same name. I think that the problem is probably not going to be even helped a little bit by renaming. But I like the idea.
All right. We are closing in towards the end of the space. At this moment, I would like to invite anybody who want to add any final comments, and then we'll ask Tim to have his closing remarks, and then, you know, Jay, you can close us off.
I just want to add that if I was going to rename user story, I would call it a piece of cake.
I do have like a kind of a tough cultural question. So the fact is that, you know, user story is supposed to be so very much less and so much less complete and so much different from specifications. How would you lead people through the culture shock of something be intentionally less?
That's a tough question.
Maybe that's an open question. I don't know.
Get out of Jira for starters.
Yeah, we never talked about
do it on a post-it note or a 3x5.
I always thought that the problems that a lot of us see now with how user stories are created is actually a Red Hat, and the actual problem is the person is not coming to the team with the problem anymore. The person's coming to the team with solution, and then seeing how user stories are set up are a outcome from that.
I would totally agree with that. Yeah, that's going even further than. But yeah, that's even further than a detailed analysis up front. We've gone so far into detailed analysis, we know all the solutions. And that's, you know, that's a big part of the problem. Yep.
So one point that we wanted to discuss today was how have some of the tools like Jira hindered user stories?
I think that'd be a great topic for, I don't know what we have scheduled for next week, but I think that'd be a great, I think tools in general would be a great discussion on its own. I don't know how you all feel about that, but I feel like we could definitely spend a good hour discussing how tools are impacting different levels of the work.
All right, we're almost at the top of the hour. We have another speaker joining on the speaker. Let's see what he has to say, and then we can go towards the closing remarks. Hey, Sarah, go ahead and speak.
Hi, everybody. I'm Caicedo. I would like to go a bit further on what Otto other commented, is that I always have some struggles trying to figure out what is below a user story, and I know I'm talking about applications like Jira or similars, because more when you are trying to do less to or identify that you are maybe doing too much, it gets difficult to understand what's the level of abstraction that you have for a user story and maybe for tasks or subtasks or whatever is below a user story. So I would like if we can discuss about a bit about that in order to make clarity on what is doing less. And maybe we can start just selling it as doing the same, but on a longer span of time or things like that.
Okay, so if I understand the question, you're asking, what is the how are you able to communicate less in a user story? Is that what you're asking?
No, I think it's more like if we identify that a story is going into too much detail, or maybe we are just still brainstorming and the story is getting bigger and bigger and we started slicing it. How can we also make clarity on what we can really slice or divide, how it's going to be sliced as user story?
I think he's trying to ask how what different ways you can actually slice a user story. So I've shared a tweet on top of the space from Tim Oettinger that talks about one of his blogs that talks about story splitting and how to do that. So I think that would be really helpful for you, and maybe we can even schedule a space on that topic in the coming weeks. But I think this is a good time to kind of close the space. So Timothy, any ending remarks? And then Jay, go ahead and close us up.
I just thank you for all of your thoughts and questions. And I've enjoyed this time of discussing these things. And I think the more that can be communicated, the ideas behind what are the guiding principles of that we're using to improve the way we work, I think the more that can be communicated and more that can be understood, the better all of our lives will be.
Awesome. Thank you so much for taking out the time today and sharing your thoughts with us. And thank you everybody in the audience and on the speaker panel for joining and contributing. Next week, we will come back with another topic, another space. We'll have Matthew Carlson, another coach from Industrial Logic, and we'll be talking about high-performing teams and how to achieve high-performance teams. So that will be an interesting topic to discuss. This is a recorded session. So as soon as the space is closed, the recording will be available for people who joined late, or if you want to share it with your friends, colleagues, you can share the recording a lot of people come back and listen into the recordings because everybody can't really join in on the live session. And from here, Jay, just close us out and we'll see you next week.
Yeah, thanks everyone for joining today. Thank you, Tim, for leading this discussion. If anyone had a question that didn't get answered or had a thought they wanted to share, please feel free to reach out to Tim via DM. Again, we do this space. We host this space every Friday from 3 to 4 Eastern time. So if you would like to be featured and lead a discussion, or if there's a topic that you would like us to highlight or use for a Friday, please let us know. Again, thank you everyone for joining. Have a great and safe weekend, and we hope to see you again next Friday.
Thank you.